Hello everyone and welcome to Be Better Gamer Wrestling. I am Be Better Gamer. If this is your first time coming to my YouTube channel, I do Let's Plays of WWF No Mercy, WCW NW Revenge, and Virtual Pro Wrestling 2, the AKI developed N64 wrestling games, some of the best wrestling games on the planet. Definitely my favorite wrestling games of all time. I haven't played all the wrestling games in the world, but of what I've played, these are the best. Or I guess I should say they're my favorite then. They're not the best maybe, because maybe you think other games are your favorites, and that's fine, that's cool. We're not really here to say which game is better than the other, but they're definitely hold a special place in my heart, and they're very important to me, so much so that I've gone and created this YouTube channel to do all these Let's Plays. And today I'm continuing on with my Let's Play series for Virtual Pro Wrestling 2, my favorite of the AKI developed wrestling series. It was a Japanese only release, and it was made right after WrestleMania 2000 and right before WWF No Mercy. It was released in January of 2000. So I'm doing the Royal Road Secession mode. This is the 8th episode in the Royal Road Secession mode. Man, that's so tough to say, especially when you're sick. Like, I'm a little sick. I'm a little under the weather. I've been under the weather for a while. Blame the winter. Anyway, last episode, the whole episode was the World's Strongest Tag Determination League. And that's the big, major All Japan Pro Wrestling Tag Team Tournament that they hold every year. And that was the whole episode. The whole episode was that. The first match in the tag league, I lost to Stan Hansen and Vader. It was my very first loss I suffered in Royal Road Secession mode. Royal Road Secession mode, if you don't know, is basically like Road to WrestleMania, like, you know, in WrestleMania 2000. And it was the first loss I suffered. So the whole time I'm kind of nervous, because it's like, oh man, I hope Stan Hansen and Vader don't end up winning all their matches. And that's pretty much what ends up happening. I come in first place because I've won the rest of my matches, but look who came in second: Stan Hansen and Vader. So I'm not gonna lie, I was pretty nervous going into this match, because like I've mentioned in my other videos, I'm playing on expert. Now, it was pointed out to me when I was doing my WWF No Mercy Let's Play videos that, you know, I had the difficulty on expert, and someone pointed out that the difficulty actually doesn't matter when you do you know, the championship mode in WWF No Mercy, because they change the difficulty depending on the storyline and depending on, you know, what matches you're doing. And I never knew that. I always thought the difficulty was similar to how it was done in WrestleMania 2000 and in Virtual Pro Wrestling 2, where if you had it on the hardest difficulty in that in the game, that's how it was in the mode. At least that's how I still believe it is for Virtual Pro Wrestling 2. I don't think changing the difficulty, you know, doesn't have an effect on it. I don't think it gets harder as you go along, because, you know, definitely when you start out, as you can see, you know, if you watch some of my first episodes where I did the Royal Road Secession mode, you can obviously tell they are playing on a higher difficulty. So, you know, I've played this game long enough to really get a sense of when I'm facing the computer on a harder difficulty. I mean, I only play on expert. I only play on, you know, the highest difficulty in all the games. So for me to lose that first match in Royal Road Secession mode, not only does it ruin my perfect record — I was hoping to go for a perfect record as the first playthrough of Royal Road Secession mode on this YouTube channel, on this Let's Play channel — but it scared me, because I didn't want to end up losing the whole tournament. So I ended up winning the whole tournament, which is good, but I don't want to lose the final match. This is the deciding match. So, you know, first person, second person, this will declare the true winner of the World's Strongest Tag League Tournament. Very similar to how the World's Strongest Tag League Tournament is done. It's done in a league format. They do it over the course of several events and shows, much like the G1 Climax Tournament, which passed, you know, in the summertime, or the more recent New Japan, you know, tag tournament, the G1 Tag Tournament that New Japan had. Basically the same thing, the World's Strongest Tag Determination League. And the way they do it in real life is they'll have blocks. So then the winner of Block A will face the winner of Block E. I just jumped all the way from Block A to Block E. Winner of Block A will face the winner of Block B. But that's not how it's done here. It's just done in one league format, but they still have the first and second, you know, ranked team face each other. So I'm facing Hanson and Vader. Still scared that I'm going to lose to them. Because the last time I faced them was before the tag was at the beginning of the tag tournament, I should say. And they beat me. So now it's like, oh, I hope they don't beat me again. Like, I'm really nervous in this one. Chono and Tenzan, please don't let me down. But this is going to be an exciting episode because a lot of stuff happens in this episode. And I got a lot of cool things I want to talk about this episode, but I have to make sure I get through this match. Now, I have, in the past, way back in the day, gone through Royal Road Secession mode undefeated. I've done it. It's not impossible. It's just every now and then, you know, I'll slip up. I'll lose a match. So hopefully I don't lose any more matches in Royal Road Secession mode. Hopefully I don't lose any important matches. You definitely don't want to lose, you know, you don't want to lose these things because if you beat the World's Strongest Tag League, if you win the World's Strongest Tag League, you unlock certain wrestlers. And, you know, there's other moments. If you win the Triple Crown or if you win, you know, the Battle Royal or if you win certain things, you unlock a wrestler. If you don't win that match, you can either quit out and not save it and start it again, you know, the cheesy way, or you would have to basically start all over and, you know, hopefully win it your next playthrough. Obviously, I don't recommend doing that. I just recommend if you lose, just don't save it, quit out, and, you know, try again. Because you definitely don't want, you know, we're in the month of December right now with the Royal Road Secession mode with Chono, and it's taken me quite a while to get here. You know, it's not... Hey, shut it. This is the second time. The second time she's barking when I'm recording.
Stop it.
No recording. I guess it can't be a podcast unless someone interrupts me or my dog starts barking. So, but whatever, I'm going to keep it fast and loose here. I'm not going to start all over because my dog is being stupid and barking at other dogs. I love my dog, by the way. I should just say that. I got it recently in September. She was a rescue dog and she's perfect in every way. Anyway, So I definitely don't want to lose. Got Stan Hansen, putting him on the ropes now with Chono. But, you know, that's part of the fun of Royal Road Secession mode because the AI in Virtual Pro Wrestling 2, I've said it before and I'll say it again, the AI in Virtual Pro Wrestling 2 was the best, in my opinion. I know in the beginning of the video I said, alright, I don't like to do bests, you know, everyone's got their own opinion, you should really more so say what's your favorite as opposed to what's the best, and I definitely try to prescribe to that philosophy a lot in my daily life, but let's be real, the AI in Virtual Pro Wrestling 2 was the best. It was the most well-balanced, the computer gave you the most challenge, but it also didn't feel like you were getting cheated out of, like, anything. The system was pretty much perfected by the time they got to Virtual Pro Wrestling 2. The improvements from Virtual Pro Wrestling 2 to WWF No Mercy, a lot of it was graphical, a lot of it was match types and modes, and they changed only a few things around in terms of the game mechanics and how it worked, and a lot of those changes actually made the game easier to play, easier to win. But in terms of just gameplay, solid, you know, with the AI, they had nailed it. It was done. It was perfect. It was pretty close to perfect when they came out with Virtual Pro Wrestling 2, which is why it was so revolutionary when I got my hands on it, because it was light years. It felt light years away from WrestleMania 2000. Even though it wasn't, you know, released too far off from when WrestleMania 2000 was released. Because WrestleMania 2000 was released in, like, November of 99. So here we get this one in January 2000. And somehow, in those few months, they had to have two teams working on it at the same time. Because this game is an expansive game. And, you know, they came out with one every year. But, you know, Virtual Pro Wrestling 64 came out in 97, so you got, you know, Virtual Pro Wrestling 64 and 97, then you got No Game in 98, No Game in 99, you get it at the beginning of the year 2000, so about 2 years or so. It wasn't a yearly release, so it almost makes me wonder if they were building this game as soon as they finished development on Revenge, right? And they were building this game probably maybe earlier than WrestleMania 2000. I don't know. It's hard to say. It's hard to say, because then you got to think about when they got the different licenses, when that went in effect, how early did they start building WrestleMania 2000. Maybe they started building Virtual Pro Wrestling 2 first because they knew their contract with WCW was running out. So they started, well, let's go ahead and start making a sequel to our Japanese game. And we'll just make a Japanese game. And then they ended up getting the WWF contract. So then they were like, all right, well, let's release that one first. Because they want us to release that one right away so that we can get another one out the year after. I don't know. It's hard to say. It's hard to say when you think about the development. You look at the years and you think about how long it probably... Because this game, none of these wrestlers were carried over. Well, that's not true. Ultimate Dragon was carried over, essentially. Who else was carried? I mean, you had a lot of the wrestlers carried over from Virtual Pro Wrestling 64, I guess you could say. But a lot had changed by then. A lot of the character models were completely different. A lot of the moves were changed around. The animations were changed around. You know, just look at how WCW NWO World Tour looked completely different from Revenge. And look how some of those characters, you know, in Revenge, they play a lot differently than they did and just look how a lot of those characters in World Tour, how they played differently from Revenge. I had a brain fart there, just completely lost my train of thought, maybe because I was getting distracted because I beat Stan Hansen Invader. I was only a little bit nervous, I'm not gonna lie. I mean, come on, let's be real, that loss to them in the World's Strongest Tag League was kind of a fluke. But here we go, you beat them, and when you beat them, this is what you get. You get, something's happening screen. I don't know what it's saying. I don't read Japanese. It's definitely like special event or something, special match. It's definitely going to be a special match. Going to be facing some hidden characters. As you can tell, the Japanese writing is still there. Who's coming out? Who's coming out to face Chono and Tenzan after I've beaten Stan Hansen Invader to claim victory in the world? I haven't even gotten to my ceremony yet, and these guys are already coming out and they're like, no, we want to fight you. It's the same thing like what happened with the Funks. When I had to unlock the Funks, you do that tournament, that tag team tournament, and then you have to fight the Funks before you can get your trophy. So here we go, coming out. You might not recognize them because, again, this game only had the All Japan Pro Wrestling license. But look at that. Who do you think that is? I'll give you a few seconds to gloss it over. It's a tag team. They're coming out. You know, one's wearing the red singlet, the other one the black. All right. I guess we could kind of. Ooh, okay. Maybe they don't. I don't think they have their right faces. Who does it look like? Have you given up? Have you figured it out yet? If you're a big fan of Japanese wrestling and All Japan Pro Wrestling and didn't know that these characters were in the game, maybe you figured it out by now, but I'll keep the secret from you no longer. That's supposed to be Terry Bam Bam Gordy. Or that is Terry Bam Bam Gordy, I should say, not supposed to be. And that's Dr. Death Steve Williams. And again, they don't look like how they really look. After this match, I'll go into the edit mode and make them look like the way they're supposed to look. But because, you know, they only had the All Japan license, they used a lot of fake appearances for the wrestlers. But essentially, the taunts and the movesets are the wrestlers. And they have their faces in the game. They just don't give them the faces on the models to avoid copyright law. They did the same thing with the Fire Pro Wrestling series. I guess in the Japanese copyright law is a lot more lenient. I mean, it's obviously them, just they don't look like them and they don't have their faces, even though it's in the game. So I don't even know how they get away with that. And I believe even in their Japanese name, because I can't read Japanese, but from what I understand, is it doesn't actually say Dr. Death Steve Williams and Terry, you know, Bam Bam Gordy. It'll say like Dr. Lightning, you know, Bill Billiams, you know, or something stupid like that. Like, it'll say, you know, Tommy, Boom Boom, you know, Gary, you know, something like that. Something similar. Something similar to who they might be, to give you, I guess, a little bit of a hint. I don't know. You can't really do that, I think, with American copyright. I think there's been a lot of instances where, like, someone, oh, look at Fat Man. You know, this is my Fat Man, and he looks exactly like Batman, but he's red. Like, you can't get away with stuff like that here, I believe. But in Japan, they're a little bit more lenient. At least they were back, you know, when this game came out. And the Fire Pro series, you know, Fire Pro Wrestling series, they did the same thing. Like, all the wrestlers from all these different promotions, they didn't have the license for all those different promotions and all those different likenesses. They had even, they had WWF and WCW guys in those games. But they just gave them fake names, and their first appearance was a fake appearance. But if you go to the second appearance, it was their like right appearance, you know. It was so, and you could edit their appearances anyway. So that, you know, that's how Virtual Pro Wrestling 2 works. And, you know, forgive me for, you know, re-explaining this if you already know about this series and you've been following these videos for a while, but I like to always go over a lot of these you know, different things that are in this edition of the AKI wrestling series that you can't, that you don't necessarily see in the American releases with the WCW and WWF games, because, you know, I don't know who's watching this for the first time, and this might be their first exposure to the awesome game that is Virtual Pro Wrestling 2. Like, oh, what's this Japanese wrestling game that looks just like WrestleMania 2000 and No Mercy? Like, well, it's from the same series. It was just only released in Japan, and this is how they got away with copyright, and how they got like 90 something wrestlers in the game before WWE 2K16 made a big stink about having the biggest roster ever. This game definitely did have the biggest roster ever at the time, which would then be dwarfed by Fire Pro Wrestling, you know, shortly after. So, and I think I'm, you know, I haven't gone back and done the research because I haven't really touched the Fire Pro Wrestling series in a while. When I'm done with one of these AKI games, or actually no, I can't say that, because when I'm done with one of these AKI games, I'm gonna do one of the other AKI games. I'm gonna eventually do let's plays and stuff of all the AKI games. Obviously the older ones are gonna be probably a lot shorter than these, because there's not a lot of content you can do and talk about at length. That's why I wanted to do these three first. But when I'm definitely done going through the AKI games, I'm going to start exploring a lot of the other wrestling games that have come out over the years, especially some of my other faves that I've played, and even ones that I haven't played before, because there's a lot of wrestling games that I missed out on that I wanted to play. And I'm even starting to branch out a little bit of that. If you've seen my channel, I've been doing some WWE 2K16. I wanted to do some 2K15 stuff, but I never did it. But I'm definitely going to try my best to keep up with the 2K16 content. And I don't know which one I'm going to finish first. I'll probably end up finishing Revenge first out of the three, honestly. Because in No Mercy, I'm doing all the championship mode. There's a ton of unlockables in Virtual Pro Wrestling 2. And also, I just want to explore a lot of the history with the Japanese wrestlers in this game, and all the different titles and all the different tag teams. You know, speaking of Dr. Death and Terry Gordy, I guess I should talk about them. So who is Dr. Death Williams, Steve Williams, I should say, and Terry Bam Bam Gordy? He's the first Bam Bam, all right, before Bam Bam Bigelow. Terry Bam Bam Gordy, and they were known as Satsujin Gyori. I think I'm saying that right. I'm probably saying it wrong. It's probably Giora. But they were the Miracle Violence Connection. Gotta love the Japanese translations. The Miracle Violence Connection. The most dominant tag team in All Japan Pro Wrestling in the early 90s. The most feared tag team in the rest of the world in the early 90s. This was a dream tag team. I mean, Terry Gordy, obviously Terry Gordy from the Fabulous Freebirds. If that's probably how maybe most people listening to this know him. Okay, the Fabulous Freebirds, big popular team in the 80s. You know, the original members were Terry Gordy, Michael Hayes, and Buddy Jack Roberts. Very popular in Southern wrestling. Jimmy Garvin and Brad Armstrong, when he was known as Bad Street, they were also associated with the Fabulous Freebirds, but those were the original three. It was Terry Gordy. Terry Gordy was the muscle. You know, Michael Hayes was the showman. And then Buddy Roberts was like the all-around kind of like jack of all trades. And you know, that's where the Freebird rule comes from. If you watch current WWE, you know, the New Day, they're always talking about the Freebird rule. Freebird rule, because Terry Gordy and Michael Hayes and Buddy Roberts, you know, two of them, that, you know, they would be the tag team champions. But since two of them were the tag team champions, but they were a cohesive three-person unit, which was pretty much like the first of its kind around that time, even, you know, I think predating the Horsemen. I'm not sure. It might have been like right around the same time. But their rule was like any two of them could defend the title. It didn't have to be, you know, just Gordy and Michael Hayes. It could be Gordy and Buddy Roberts, or it could be Michael Hayes and Buddy Roberts. So that was the Freebird rule. NWO used the Freebird rule a little bit, mostly because a lot of the guys didn't want to show up to the tapings. But they used the Freebird rule. But the New Day, they use the Freebird rule now. They always change about who gets to defend. That's where it came from, the Freebirds, Terry Gordy. So Terry Gordy, you know, made his, you know, self known because of that. Steve Williams, very popular wrestler as well in the 80s. You might know him from being part of the Varsity Club with Rick Steiner and Mike Rotunda, managed by Kevin Sullivan back in the day. Both legitimate tough guy competitors, amateur wrestling background. I believe both also have a football background, both playing college. I'm not so sure about Bam Bam, but definitely Steve Williams. So when they got together in All Japan, they formed in All Japan. Okay, and how fitting, because, you know, this game has the All Japan license, but they formed together in All Japan, and from the moment they formed, they were instantly one of the most popular top heel tag teams in the world. All right, they were producing some high caliber matches, and to this day they have a lot of records that still hold up. They held the World Tag Team Championship, you know, if in All Japan, the World Tag Team Championship, which was the two belts that you see in this game when they come out as the tag team champions. I believe I already have those belts as Chono and Tenzan, if I remember. But it's the unified PWF and NWA international titles. That is All Japan's World Tag Team Championship. They held that title 5 times. 3 of the times they held those titles, they held it for well over 100 days, okay? So it was not like, you know, 10 days here, 10 days there. They definitely hold it for a long time. They're ranked 4th all time in most combined days as champions, holding the titles for a total combined days of 484 days, I should say. And speaking of the World's Strongest Tag League, it's only fitting that we're facing these guys because they won the 1990 and the 1991 World's Strongest Tag League back to back, first team to ever do that, to win the tag league back to back, and then they would come in second in 1992. So the 3 years basically that they were together, they were on top. They almost won it 3 years in a row, but they were the first team to win the tournament back to back, which is really impressive. At the time that they were tearing it up in All Japan, they went to WCW briefly, and they started feuding with some of the WCW teams there. And they were feuding with the Steiners. Now, their first meet up with the Steiners, I believe, was around the time that they were doing the NWA Tag Team Championship Tournament. This was to crown the official NWA Tag Team Champions, because before, all the different promotions that were part of the NWA, they had their own tag team belts, including you know, Jim Crockett Promotions, which was WCW. They had their own tag team belt, so NWA wanted their own belt. Steve Williams and Terry Gordy beat the Steiner Brothers in the first match of that tournament. They end up to go on to win the entire thing, becoming the first ever NWA Tag Team Champions. But before they do that, they also beat the Steiners in another match at another WCW event to be crowned the WCW Tag Team Champions. So they hold the WCW Tag Team Championship belts, they win the NWA Tag Team Championship belts, and they basically do the same thing they did in All Japan. They walk around with two tag team titles at the same time. Pretty impressive stuff. When they met the Steiners, and you can watch both matches. You can watch the match from the NWA Tag Tournament, and you can watch the WCW Tag Team Championship match between Gordy and Williams and the Steiner Brothers on the WWE Network. I highly recommend you go watching them. I highly recommend go watching any Steve Williams and Terry Gordy tag team match from All Japan Pro Wrestling. Watch any of their numerous title bouts. You know, they capture the thing five times. Watch their matches from the World Tag Leagues. Great tag team. They really were. You know, it's a style of wrestling that I feel like has been kind of lost in the modern day era, but I think it still holds up. The psychology is still there, the ferociousness and the intensity with which they compete, but they're also really good heels. I mean, they're, you know, it's tough being a big badass heel, and I've talked about this a few times. I've kind of talked about it recently in my Jericho WCW NWO Revenge Let's Play, how he was a smart, you know, whiny kind of heel. But to be a big, tough, badass heel, it's tough because, you know, why would you run away if you could just destroy the competition? And then if you can just destroy the competition, eventually everyone's going to start cheering for you because they're going to, you know, you're so cool, you're so badass. You know, unless, like, you're always, you know, becoming the guy to hate. Unless you're doing something that's get the fans to hate you, even though you're this unstoppable force. Terry Gordy and Steve Williams, you know, they're no chumps. You look at them, you're like, man, I wouldn't mess with them. But they were great heels because even though they were so competitive and athletic, they were always like kind of the first ones to step over the line. You know, they were the first ones to, oh, you think, you know, especially like you watch that match with the Steiners and it's like, okay, they're feeling each other out, they're doing their amateur wrestling stuff, and then boom, like, you know, Terry Gordy slaps Rick Steiner, you know, uncalled for. You know, and it's just like stuff like that. Like they'll do the whole, you know, distracting the ref so that the ref didn't see when the good guys tagged out. So he's sending the guy back to his corner. They'll do the whole thing where they're trying to sneak, you know, behind the back and get the victory over the good guys when the ref's not looking. Just a lot of dirty tactics. Like they fought dirty as gifted and as powerful as they were. They fought dirty, and that's what made you hate them. And they were great at it. You know, you love to boo them. It just seemed like a team you wanted to boo. But you know, so it makes sense that you kind of have to unlock them here at the World Tag Team Championship. With, I mean, the World's Strongest Tag. Blah, 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 blah. Oh man, it's tough sometimes when you're sick. So there you go, I unlocked them. Obviously they don't look like, but you know, them, but we're gonna go fix that. But yeah, they were a big deal. They were a big deal tag team, especially in All Japan Pro Wrestling. You know, and they also had individual success within All Japan on their own and in other parts of Japan. Here we go, we unlocked something else. Now this is something I forgot about until I unlocked it. But I unlocked the black and white filter. So at any time, you can go into the options mode and you can change the filter to be black and white. So it's like you're wrestling like really old matches. So if you want to recreate really old Antonio Inoki and Andre the Giant matches that were watched in black and white, you can do that. It's really cool. It's a really neat little feature that, you know, they didn't have to put in, but they did, you know, because it just harkens back to, you know, an era where wrestling was watched in black and white. How cool is that? That's such a cool thing. And then also, like, different referees, and you can unlock a special referee in this game, too. You can unlock, like, the Tokyo Dome. Like, the unlockables in this game are just so awesome, so great. But here we go. So I'm editing now, Terry Gordy. And this is, you know, what I try to do when I unlock someone right away. I try to just go into edit mode and fix them. And of course, I'm not doing this by memory. I mean, I'm inserting their name by memory, but there's a guide that you kind of have to just Google to find it. I think the only place you can find it, I should re-upload it, like, through my own site that I never update. But there's a guide that was made way back in the day, and it was made by a guy who called himself Shima. And way back in the day, there was a website I used to go to, like the Ice. I think his name was Ice Master, like the Ice Master Dojo. And he used to, and this was like, you know, this was early days of the internet. All right, we didn't have YouTube and stuff like that. We had a lot of chat rooms and message boards, and you know, and Angel Fire websites and things like that. But someone had posted an edit guide, basically going through the entire roster and giving them their proper outfits, or at least outfits that looked close to their proper outfits, because again, it has everything in the game here. So here we go, number 70. As you can see, it's yellow because it's hidden, but that's Terry Gordy's face. That's Bam Bam Terry Gordy's face. And now you basically just gotta, you know, mess around and make him look like Terry Gordy. And you know, some of it could be kind of subjective, you know, especially with like maybe skin tones and hair color for certain wrestlers and things like that. But you know, fortunately, a lot of these guys, you know, what they wore was very simple, it was very basic. Especially someone like Terry Gordy, who just had plain black trunks, you know, and black boots, and that's it. You know, it's not really too hard to go through and edit all of them. But this guy Shima, he did this guide way back in the day, all right, when this game came out, and it's still around. You can still find it. I think I do post a link to the edit guide, right? I think I do post a link to the edit guide in my YouTube description. At least I hope I've been doing that. Oh man, now I have to double check to see if I've been doing that. But yeah, but it's like now it's like on some message board where they're, you know, keeping the hope alive. I have it saved on my Evernote just in case, so you don't lose it forever. Because there were a few things that have been lost over the years about this game that I can't find anymore. Certain guides and websites and stuff that people had created for this game. I mean, I even uploaded way back in the day. I did some creative wrestlers for this game that I uploaded on the Ice Master site, and you can't find them. You know, that Ice Master site doesn't exist anymore. Or at least I haven't found it, or at least I haven't found like an archived version of that site. I know some people have done that. They've archived, you know, old websites and things like that, but I haven't been able to find the old Ice Master site. If you've been able to find it, please let me know. Give me a link. Someone the other day, they linked me an old Angel Fire website that had all these No Mercy calls on them that I used back in the day, that I remember vividly going back in the day. And you know, every week there was a new upload of a few new wrestlers and me being very excited. Oh, they added this person, they added that person. And I would go, and you know, they had pictures, but very few pictures, but at least it gave you an idea of what they looked like. And I was like, oh my god, this guy found an archived version of this site that I used to use back in the day. This is awesome. I was looking for this. So I would love to find stuff like that again that I used to use back in the day. But you know, a lot of it's hard to find because, again, a lot of those, like, you know, it was the old days of the internet, man. That sounds so foreign, right? The old days of the internet. I mean, this game only came out in 2000. But, man, 2000, internet era, nowhere near 2016. You know, well, it's going to be 2016 by the time this video comes out, right? 2016 internet, you know, it night and day. It really was. And, you know, I couldn't do what I'm doing right now. You know, I think a lot of people take that for granted, how far we've come with technology. Even when I was growing up, I think I took for granted how far technology had grown up until that point. And it's grown even more so now. And I think playing video games over the years at least has helped me understand that. But there's Dr. Death. Look how cool he looks. Looks just like Dr. Death now. Ready to get some action going. But yeah, so check out that edit, you know, guide. So here we go. So now, as you can tell in the upper left, I'm moving on to January. So I'm getting closer to the end of this Royal Road Session mode. I got a couple more months. I think it ends in March or April or something like that. But there's my list of upcoming events. And now, something else that I kind of forgot about. So the first night, I'm going to be at the AK Hall, right? Which is supposed to be based off the Karakian Hall in Japan. And I'm going to be doing the annual All Japan Pro Wrestling Karakian Heavyweight Battle Royal that they have every year. That you can't find any information on for some reason. They do it every year. but you just, it's, try looking it up and you'll barely find any information. You'll barely find any videos, any photos. There's not a Wikipedia. There's not a Wikipedia page on it. Nothing. You just kind of, it's just like one of those things that you know just kind of happens. But for some reason, people, like, there's a list of winners, but you can't find any of that stuff. There's no images, no photos. Like, what's going on? They just do this event and they don't record it, they don't archive it. This is basically your standard battle royal. This is the Royal Rumble. That's all this is. But I do think that if you do win this, I think they do it the same way, even though I don't know if All Japan actually does it that way, where if you get a title shot for the Triple Crown. But you do get a title shot for the Triple Crown down the line if you do win this. So this is very important to win also, because you unlock someone else if you win it. And we'll get more to that later if I beat it. So here we go. Kenta Kobashi is the first opponent coming. Of course, they start you off in as number one. But there's Kenta Kobashi. Masahiro Kakihara is making his way in. And the strategy for this one, because I am playing on the expert difficulty, is that Yoshihiro Takayama's already in. Oh, I didn't see him go in. Yoshihiro Takayama's already in. And yeah, here I go. Masahiro Chono. So I'm fourth, actually. Oh, they put me in fourth. Right? Or am I technically... Yeah, I'm fourth. They're putting me in. So, same deal. Royal Rumble. There's no countdown, obviously. You eliminate them. Someone else comes in right away. The difference with this Battle Royal than the Royal Rumble is not only can you eliminate them by throwing them over the top, you know, in this game, just knocking them out of the ring, because they go through the ropes a lot of the times, and then you can still knock them off the apron and that'll count, even though it's technically not over the top. But the difference is that you can also make the opponent pin or submit, which makes it very challenging as you as the player, because if you're sustaining a lot of damage, and let's say someone else is getting a lot of momentum and their special's going up, they can very easily put you away. Or even someone new who's just come in and you've been badly damaged, if they can get off like a good strong grapple and then hit you with like the right submission hold or something like that, you could be done. You don't even have to be thrown out over the top. So a lot more strategy is involved in this kind of battle royal than just your normal Royal Rumble kind of rules where you just gotta eliminate them by sending them over the top rope. And again, I'm playing on expert difficulty, so this is going to be a challenge in itself. Steve Williams won one of these. Steve Williams, you know, from the Terry Gordy, you know, Miracle Violence Connection tag team, he actually won this Karakian Battle Royal. He actually won it twice. He won it in 1995 and 2000. And here's Jun Akiyama. So right away, this is what I'm going to try to do. I'm going to try to get someone out real quickly. Try to get myself in a position where I can weak grapple them, whip them to the ropes, and then, you know, try to run and close out. You know, Chono's got that running Yakuza kick, which I can pull off kind of quickly. Getting double power bomb doesn't help. But Chono does have that arm counter where it's a grapple move. This is an automatic counter where I don't go into like the back and forth. Oh, wait, he does have the back and forth with the kick, right? Yeah, I think he does. Why did I like all of a sudden forget? This is a dangerous position right here. Luckily, no one's looking at me. Takayama, look how much time I'm spending on the apron. Takayama kicks me, and I'm on the apron, and no one was looking at me. It could have been all over right there. Just all over. Give him a nut shot for his troubles, for trying to eliminate me. That's his meter on the bottom right. As you can tell, it went down from orange after I countered him. So I gotta be very careful. I don't know why I'm going after Takayama. He's the most dangerous man in the ring right now, because his meter is definitely higher than everyone else's. I'm trying to get him even, but here we go. Boom, showed the block. Nice and easy. Yakuza kick. That's what I'm gonna try to do. Look, Kakihara goes out at the same time. Akiyama's on fire. Give him a running grapple. Perfect time to hit him with the running grapple, because actually, as someone's coming out, the computer stops. And he waits for someone to come out. There's Morikeya Moss Man, aka Teo Okia. And here comes Tenzan, my own partner. What are you doing in here? They always send in your partner, no matter who you're teaming with. They always send in your partner in the All Japan, you know, battle royal. most of the competitors, if not all the competitors, I think are going to be pulled from the All Japan roster. I don't remember if any guys show up that's not part of the All Japan roster. If you do a regular battle royal in this game, and the same rules apply to all the other games with all the battle royals and the Royal Rumbles. So how it randomly picks people is it'll go through each roster and it'll pull like one person or two people from that roster, and then it'll move on to the next one. So the way this is set up, so theoretically, if this was set up in the way where I was just doing a regular battle royal, like in exhibition mode, so I have All Japan Pro Wrestling 1, All Japan Pro Wrestling 2, and then All Japan Pro Wrestling 3. So it'll pick a guy from All Japan Pro Wrestling 1, it'll pick a guy from All Japan Pro Wrestling 2, it'll pick a guy from All Japan Pro Wrestling 3, and then it'll pick someone from New Japan 1, and then New Japan 2, and it'll go in order. So you'll even get some MMA fighters showing up, you'll get some of the hidden wrestlers showing up if you have them unlocked, and then it'll just recycle and it'll go through. So that's how they do it. That's how it does it also in WrestleMania 2000 and in WWF No Mercy. But you can also select, you can also predetermine who you want to enter and when, which I guess is neat if you want to make sure only certain people show up in the Rumble. Like, you know what me and my friend used to do, so we used to do these battle royals where we would actually turn off we would turn off the over the top, and you could only win by like pin, submission, knockout. You know, we would call them like these endurance rumbles, where basically it was an excuse just to play this game for like 4 hours straight, because that's how long it would take. It would take a very long time. It wouldn't take 4 hours, but it would take a very long time to go through a 40-man battle royal where you can only pin, submit, and knock out every person that came through. And part of the reason why we did that is because we wanted to see who would get the highest score. Obviously, you want to try to get as many eliminations as possible with just the first guy you picked, but there's no way you're making it through the first guy you picked. So if you just leave it to be random, a lot of times you end up with people you don't want to play as. So what we used to do is we used to put it so that you could select who enters the Rumble and then just randomize, you know, by pressing up C, the character selection. And then if it landed on someone we liked, we were like, oh yeah, let's throw them in. Let's throw this all. And you know, and that was also to avoid like no MMA guys getting in, because it's always difficult when the MMA guys show up, because they're always going to kick your ass. And it's also unfair when you get an MMA guy, because then you're just going to kick someone else's ass. Because MMA guys definitely have a bigger advantage in this game than the regular, you know, wrestlers and the mixed martial and the martial artists. Boom, big Yakuza kick, sending Toshiaka Kawada. Tenzan's already out. I missed when Tenzan went out. I wasn't looking. Did I eliminate Tenzan? Betrayed him. Akira Tao. Yeah, so it's basically just cycling through the All Japan Pro Wrestling roster, which is neat. You know, whatever, no big whoop. But, you know, again, I gotta be very careful. So, another thing I'm doing, as you notice, and I do this in all the battle royals across all the different games, you know, I'm trying to taunt as much as I can when the wrestlers are changing. Because the momentum is key. You don't, a lot of the reasons why you can reverse moves is if you have a higher momentum than your opponent. Now, if they have a meter that's equivalent to yours, I think there's maybe like a little bit of like rolling the dice that goes on behind the scenes to decide who get, you know, if a counter could take place, or maybe just the percentage of the counter is a lot lower and it just increases as, you know, the difference in meter is widened. I don't know how to best describe it, but basically you want to have a higher meter than your opponent, okay? And you want to take advantage. It's not cheesy, it's not cheap. I'm giving you the okay. It's okay to taunt a lot in a Rumble, especially in an over-the-top battle Royal Rumble that you're playing on hard difficulty in Royal Road Succession, because you want to do this once, you want to do it right, and you don't want to have to do it again. You definitely want to taunt as much as you can so you get your meter up, so that you have that little bit of an edge when the new guys come in. Because remember, you're taking damage throughout the whole match. Okay, so those new guys already have an advantage on you, because you've been racking up damage, so they could potentially choke you out, you know, hit you with a submission move, pin you, hit you with a very big strong grapple. You know, there's gonna be times where you're gonna get double teamed. It's just gonna happen. It's very hard to avoid getting double teamed in one of these match types, because, you know, again, you got four guys in the ring, you're bound to cross paths with someone else, with another, you know, two guys fighting. Here goes Mike Awesome. Mike Awesome is from FMW. He's from the FMW roster, but he also has appeared in the Royal Road Succession mode. So, you know, maybe they're pulling from all the people who have already appeared in Royal Road Succession mode. You know, I wouldn't be surprised if Hayabusa shows up. Or Super Delphin, because they've appeared in like the tournaments. I love Chono's Yakuza kick, because you can pull it off at such a good angle and still knock them straight back so that they can go over the ropes. Here's Mike Awesome getting out of here. Yoshinara Ogawa. Yoshinara Ogawa is a junior heavyweight. And I know they do a junior heavyweight version of the Battle Royal. And I think the Battle Royal is only like 20 people. I don't think it's an insanely big battle royal. I think it's like 20 people in the All Japan Korakuen Hall battle royal that they do every January. That's the name of it. I don't think it's called anything else. The Korakuen Hall Battle Royal. That's it. That's a very original name. But yeah, here we go. We got Stan Hansen, probably angry, out for revenge from him and Vader not being able to capture the World's Strongest Tag Determination League Championship from us. You know, usually what happens is, and really in All Japan, I forgot to mention when I was talking about the World Tag League, but the Tag Team Championships get vacated for the Tag League, and the winner of the Tag League becomes the champions. And, you know, essentially they're supposed to defend it for the whole year, but obviously that isn't always the case. Very few times have people won that tournament and kept the titles until the next tournament when it was vacated, and then even to win it again is another feat in itself. You're basically being asked to hold the championships for a whole year. I don't know how I feel about that. It's kind of a neat concept, but at the same time I feel like it's counterproductive, because you're gonna have title changes. You're gonna want title changes, so why vacate the titles? Maybe to give it an importance, like, hey, you know, here's an opportunity for anyone now. I guess it makes sense in that way, because, you know, there's a lot fewer dates, so there's a lot fewer opportunities for titles to be defended, so therefore very limited people probably are getting an opportunity to fight for the tag team titles, so maybe that's why they do it. I don't know. I like the whole, you win the tournament, so that instantly makes you the number one contender, because you've proven yourself. But I guess it's also an incentive too to get the tag team champions into it, to also, like, you know, show their worth. Like, hey, alright, you're the tag team champions, but can you retain? Can you basically keep your titles going and win the tournament? And I think actually Terry Gordy and Steve Williams did do that one year. I think they went into the tournament as the champions in one of the years they won and left as the champions as well. I could be wrong. I should look it up, but I'm not gonna. I could look it up right now. I have time. I'm gonna look it up. I'm being lazy. They were the World Tag Team Champions. Let's Wikipedia this nonsense. Williams and Terry Gordy. Williams and Terry Gordy. No, I was wrong. They never went into it as champions. They almost went into it as champions at one point, but they didn't. So, in their first reign, they held it for 135 days, and then they lost it to Great Kabuki and Jumbo Tsuruta, who only had it for 8 days because it was vacated for the tournament right after that. So that's kind of weird. Why would they lose it to Kabuki and Tsuruta 8 days before the tournament? Oh, no, wait, no, that's not why they lost it. I'm reading it wrong. Oh, wait, yeah. No, yeah, I'm totally reading it right. Oh no, I'm reading it wrong. So they lost it to Kabuki and Tsuruta, and then it was vacated because Kabuki left All Japan Pro Wrestling for SWS, which was the Super World of Sports, which I think Genichiro Tenryu helped create, one of the many, many promotions he helped create. So the title was just vacated from all that time until the World's Strongest Tag League, and then Terry Gordy and Steve Williams just ended up winning the titles back. So, you know, I get, maybe that's why I thought they went into it as champions, because of that. So the only thing about the Battle Royal in this game is that you don't have a counter. So I know I've been in it for a little over 11 minutes. I know I've eliminated a bunch of people, but I don't know how far I am till the end. So it gets kind of tense. It gets kind of tense here because it's like, oh, you know, Misawa's here now. Baba's here. Vader's here. All the big names are here. I don't know if they do that on purpose. I don't know if they start throwing out the really big heavy hitters in this game, you know, in terms of like ranking on the roster as you get closer to the end. Maybe they do. But it definitely feels like it should be in the end when you have Misawa, Vader, and Baba. But we'll know when we're getting to the end, because someone will show up, and that'll be a big key, you know, signifier. Here's Jinsei Shinzaki, another non-All Japan Pro wrestler, but has shown up in the Royal Rose Succession mode. So you do get a few guest stars. You're not going to get anyone from New Japan showing up unless they're your tag team partner. That's why Tenzan shows up. And I believe your tag team partner always shows up in that spot. Like the 7th spot, I think it is. 7th or 8th spot, they show up. Here we go, Michael Barton. So, I totally forgot to mention when Johnny Ace was in the ring. Because Johnny Ace got eliminated early on, and Johnny Ace and Mike Barton had a tag team going. But so I talked about how Terry Gordy and Dr. Death, they were tag team champions for 5 times, right? But Gordy held the title 2 other times. He held it with Stan Hansen 2 other times. So he was a 7-time world tag team champion in his own right. Dr. Death was an 8-time tag team champion in his own right, and one of the times he won it was with Johnny Ace, obviously Johnny Laurinaitis, as we all know and love him today in the WWE. Here's Andre the Giant. There we go, that's the guy I was waiting for. Andre the Giant's in this game. Yes, the Andre the Giant looks exactly like Andre the Giant. I guess they didn't care about using his face, but that's totally Andre the Giant, just with a blue singlet. I mean, that's pretty much him. You don't really have to change it. You know, you could make him look old school Andre the Giant, give him the afro in this game. Boom, big leg drop. So when Andre the Giant comes out, that's pretty much the end. And I don't know for sure if you have to eliminate Andre the Giant to unlock him, but basically if you win this, you unlock him. Now there you go, you see I did the big super heavyweight body slam. This was the first introduction to the super heavyweight class that you would see in WWF No Mercy, and obviously Andre the Giant was also an unlockable character in that game as well. But boom, there goes Andre the Giant. His meter blacks out. You know, there we go. I'm setting up Shohei Baba for the submission. Maybe I can get a submission victory real quick. Take him out. But, yeah, they didn't have, you know, the super heavyweight class in any of the previous AKI wrestling games, but Andre the Giant is the only one in this game who's a super heavyweight, which is kind of neat. It makes him special in that sense. It also makes him pretty difficult to play as. But in WWF No Mercy, we would get Andre the Giant, Rikishi, and Viscera would be the super heavyweights. And obviously you can create your own super heavyweights. If you want to make Yokozuna in that game, you totally can. They have his attire. Could put him as a super heavyweight. Or if you want to create your own made-up character and he's a super heavyweight, totally go for it. And it's actually calculated by weight. If you make your character a certain weight, in this game they have 3 weight classes. They have junior weight, they have heavyweight, and they have super heavyweight, just like how they would have in No Mercy. In No Mercy, it doesn't really make too much of a difference for having all 3 weight classes. But here, you know, the distinction between junior heavyweight and heavyweight is very important, because it's very important in Japanese wrestling in general. You know, they have a lot of specific junior heavyweight titles that are very prestigious titles, unlike how WWF treated their own light heavyweight title. You know, the cruiserweight title was handled a little bit better, a lot better, you could say, in regards to how the WWF light heavyweight title was treated. But boom, hitting Jinsei Shizaki with his own finisher, praying powerbomb, taking him out. Why am I going for pinfall wins at this point? Because, you know, I'm a little nervous that the computer might try to take me out. I'm also trying to play it really safe, because I don't want the computer eliminating me on their own by knocking me over the ropes. This is the end. I really don't want to lose this battle royal, because the restart of battle royal, you know, you just see it's taking up pretty much the whole episode, along with the one match that I, well, the two tag matches that I have. The whole rest of this episode has been dominated by this battle royal, and you don't want to do it all over again. So that's why I'm playing it super safe right now, in with trying to eliminate people with my regular special. But I notice Andre the Giant and Jussei Shizaki, they're kind of just staring at each other. They're kind of locked in that weird, that happens sometimes. Sometimes the computer will like glitch outside the ring. Usually they'll start like fighting and beating each other up, or trying to pull you out of the ring. It's Shohei Baba scaring me, sending me to the ropes. But here it's like Andre the Giant. He starts moving, starts going after Shohei Baba, luckily. But you know, sometimes they'll go after you and they'll pull you out from under the ring before you can eliminate the person, and there you go, you just lost the match. So luckily that didn't happen. I got pretty lucky there. And there we go, I beat Shohei Baba. Now I've unlocked Andre the Giant. But I don't get to do a match against him. As you're gonna see, I don't get to do, that's my little prize money for winning. For winning the tournament. I still have to wrestle. This is still all one event. Okay, it's the first event of January. And I just did this tournament. There you go, unlocking Andre the Giant. I don't think I'm gonna go in edit mode for this one, because that's his face. He looks just like how he pretty much looks in WWF No Mercy. They reused all the ads. How fitting was that? They just was like, yeah, let's just put Andre the Giant in the game. We already made him in Virtual Pro Wrestling 2. Why not? Why not put him? Yeah, super heavyweight. Let's do it. We got all that set up already. But here we go. Still, you know, there you go. Boom, we got to face Misawa now. Misawa, I don't think, is the Triple Crown champion at this point. Originally, when you start Royal Rose Succession mode, he is. But I think he lost it to Akira Tau or Kawada. I'm not sure. I don't remember who he lost it to. He's definitely not the champion. So after this match, I'll wrap up this episode. But Andre the Giant, you know, of course, I mean, obviously a lot of people probably know who Andre the Giant is. You probably know who Andre the Giant is. But if you don't, you know, go look up any WWE Andre the Giant. Look it up. You'll see. Legendary figure in wrestling because of his giantism. But early on in his career, he traveled all over the world before he signed with WWF, and big attraction everywhere he went. He wrestled a lot for New Japan Pro Wrestling, wrestled a lot against Antonio Inoki. With Antonio Inoki, it was a big deal every time Antonio Inoki and Andre the Giant fought. Andre the Giant entered in several of the G1 Climax tournaments. Or what would be later known as the G1 Climax tournament. Originally, they were called different names. Basically, every year there was an annual tournament that was held, and Antonio Inoki won a majority of them, except for in 1982 the MSG League, and in 1985 the International Wrestling Grand Prix. Again, these are the precursors to the G1 Climax, but they still count kind of a little bit as the history. Andre the Giant won both of those. He won 1982 and 1985. And he won the MSG Tag League, which was the precursor to the G1 Tag Team Tournament, in 1981 with Rene Goblet. I think I'm saying that right. And so when he signed with WWF and did the whole run, you know, he was a good guy for a while, competed at the first two WrestleManias, and then he turned heel, and he feuded with Hulk Hogan, and the whole big WrestleMania 3, you know, you all know the drill. He still participated in some matches in Japan. He still did tours in Japan. But eventually, he would move on to All Japan Pro Wrestling, and that's where he spent the majority of the end of his wrestling career, was in All Japan Pro Wrestling, teaming with Shohei Baba mostly, doing a lot of other tag teams and very few singles matches. But he competed in the 1990 and 1991 World Tag League, you know, Real World Tag League with Giant Baba, the years that Terry Gordy and Steve Williams' fault. The Miracle Violence connection, the years that they won, I should say. So it all goes full circle, doesn't it? I always find that so funny how that works out when I'm talking about these guys and these wrestlers. Somehow it's all connected with what I'm playing, what I'm talking about, how it lines up in the game, how it lined up in real life. I think that's pretty neat. I dig that. I dig that when that happens. You know, I started with the World Tag, you know, Determination League Finals, unlocked, you know, the greatest tag team to probably ever compete in the early 90s, and I end up unlocking another, you know, key figure in those tag leagues, because that was a big deal for him to be in All Japan Pro Wrestling after spending so many years working for New Japan Pro Wrestling when he worked in Japan, and working for the WWF, and especially coming off of, you know, the whole big WrestleMania 3 moment with Hulk Hogan slamming Andre the Giant, which wasn't the first time Andre the Giant had been slammed, as the WWE would want you to believe. And it also wasn't the first time Hogan slammed Andre the Giant, because they met a few times in Japan, in New Japan especially, where Hogan did slam him before. Giant Kamala slammed Andre the Giant. Antonio Inoki has slammed Andre the Giant. Andre the Giant, you know, his disorder, his abnormality, if you will, you know, his gigantism, he was a legitimate true giant, and so is the Big Show. And Big Show had the same thing Andre the Giant had, except that Big Show got it fixed. You know, I don't think they had a fix for it back when Andre the Giant had it. And so he was a giant, but he could still do all these really impressive things that a normal person could do. Andre the Giant could do a dropkick back in the early days of his career. He was very agile, very fast. He could do, flips and tumbles. Big Show talks about it too, back, you know, in the early days before he had it all fixed. He could do moonsaults and drop kicks and all these things. You were basically like superhuman, you know. The only downside was that it would deteriorate your body way faster than a normal person. And, you know, much like Andre the Giant, he didn't last long. It's also very sad that all the three people I unlocked today, they're definitely legends in the sense that, you know, they're no longer with us. All three wrestlers have passed, and that's always very sad. You know, when you unlock them in this game, back in the day, Dr. Death and Terry Gordy were still around. You know, Terry Gordy died in, when did he die? He died in 2001, and Dr. Death died in 2009. So it's kind of surreal that here I am doing these Let's Play videos, and I'm unlocking these characters who are now deceased, but at the time they were still alive. But they were, you know, they were the legends that I'm unlocking. That's the quote unquote, you know, that's what the brackets names, like the legends, the legendary wrestlers. So yeah, it's crazy. I mean, Masawa is no longer with us, you know, and he was a prominent figure in this game because he was the top guy in All Japan Pro Wrestling at the time. So it's just crazy. Oh man, I don't want to end this episode on a downer talking about dead wrestlers. But yeah, I just think it's funny that I gotta wrestle this match against Misawa after just, you know, doing this Royal Rumble, you know, this Karakian Hall, probably saying that wrong, Karakian Hall Battle Royal. And you know, I gotta continue the rest of my month of January. So that's where I'm gonna continue the next Let's Play episode. Royal Road Session Part 9 will be coming up next week, hopefully. I mean, I really wanted to talk about G1 Climax. Not the G1 Climax, I'm sorry. Wrestle Kingdom 10. So, I don't know, maybe the next episode I'll talk about Wrestle Kingdom 10. You know, the results by then, because it'll probably be over by then, right? Probably a week from now, yeah. It'll be over. So who knows? Maybe the next episode will be Wrestle Kingdom 10 review. Maybe the next episode will just be the continuation of this, because I really needed to get through this Royal Road Succession. So we'll see. But anyway, Let me know what you think. I hope you enjoyed this video. Leave a like. Leave a comment. Subscribe. All that jazz. You know what to do. Thank you so much, everyone who has watched my videos and keep watching my videos. I love you guys. Love the support. And until next time, keep watching wrestling. Thank you. See you next time.